on space propulsive techniques. I am privileged to introduce the speaker, R. Manikandan sir, who is fascinated in the field of propulsion. He has completed his PE in the field of aeronautics from Anna University with a first class distinction. He had graduated his ME in CADO CAM with a silver medal and pursuing his PhD in the area of scramjet combustion and its characteristics. The main research areas of the speaker include the scramjet engine mixing characteristics, vehicle aerodynamics, cryogenics, high-speed aircraft propulsion, rockets and missiles, aircraft materials, avionics systems. And he is a certified trainer by Wipro Mission 10X, and he had a teaching experience of 10 plus years. And he had an impressive and unique way of teaching. My experience with him made me to think in different perspectives on a topic. With the vast experience, he had published 7 research papers and wrote on a book on avionics systems. So without wasting much time, I'll hand over to the speaker, and I hope everyone will get quality information and will be beneficial. A small request to you, we will have a dedicated questionnaire section at the last. So please don't interrupt the speaker. I hope you understand. So, sir, Manikandan sir, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the intro speech. And today we are going to see, we are going to listen something about space propulsion techniques, which I am good at. And I hope I will not waste much time of you. And most of you are engineering students, and I know everything more than 1 hour will be much more boring. So I will make my presentation very short and informative. I hope everything goes well. So let me share the screen. Am I audible, Guru?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. Thank you. Right, 1 second. Let me share the screen. I hope you are seeing the screen. Right, it'll be better if I switch off my camera so that you'll not have any lag at all, because in between we'll be playing some videos. If there is any lag, you tell me, I will switch off the camera, right?
Yeah.
Okay, right. Before going to this particular presentation, we must be knowing what are the types of flight vehicles we have and how we classify. Now, usually, we classify flight vehicles into 4. Generally, it is less than 1, it is considered as subsonic. And if it is more than 1, it is supersonic. And if it is more than 5, it is hypersonic. And of course, more than 12, it is ultrasonic. And most of the rockets, most of the space vehicles which we use falls in the later last category, that is ultrasonic. And of course, if they travel at maximum more than 15 to 20. So obviously, we can't use the normal engines which we use in an airplane. We all must be knowing what are the basic differences between airplane and a rocket. Of course, airplane will travel within maybe say 10 to 15 kilometer altitude, not more than that. Whereas rockets will travel very high altitude. They enter into space and further. So it's like we it's totally different from how a normal airplane works and a rocket works. So without going in depth about what is Mach number and what is the explanation of it. Anyway, for a simple terms, I will tell you Mach number is nothing but a ratio of the vehicle speed to the speed of the sound. For example, you compare like you have a speed of sound which we normally know at 330 to 340 meter per second. So if you say your vehicle, or if it is a car, I mean, normally airplane or rocket, whatever, any vehicle which travels at the speed of sound, like 340 meter per second, you consider it as 1 Mach number. So usually the vehicles which we travel today, like commercial aircrafts and passenger, I mean, like cargo aircrafts and trainer aircrafts, all will fall less than 1. That is, it may not be go more than 0.7, 0.8. There are so many issues. I don't want to discuss about that. Why you are not going more than 1. why most of the passenger aircrafts are going less than 0.4, 0.5, 0.6 and all. Because that's a different category that comes under aerodynamics. And if you go further, you can say if you go more than one, there'll be a lot of problems, like there'll be formation of heavy drag that may push the vehicle backwards. So you'll have a lot of heavy drag and you do have high level of aerodynamic heating and so on. So passenger aircraft will not go more than Mach number 0.8, 0.9. Of course, there are some research and United Airlines, they may go with Mach number more than one from New York to London. There is a technology which is upcoming. There was technology which was called Concorde. There was an airline which was called Concorde, which traveled Mach number more than one, but still there were some issues. So that's why it was stopped from service. So usually you can say passenger aircraft will not go more than one as of now, right? Okay, so it's very safe that it goes more than it goes between like 0.5 to 0.7, 0.8 like that. Now supersonic, as I said earlier, Mach number greater than one, normally you can see fighter aircrafts and other aircraft like which cruise at Mach number more than, which cruise at very high speeds, will fall under supersonic speed. And coming to hypersonic, we'll discuss this hypersonic. This is a very interesting segment out of this four, because ultrasonic, like as I said, you do have rockets which was invented way before, even before hypersonic, supersonic aircraft and all. So if you go into a rocket science, this was started by Chinese people. They only started inventing rockets, and it was like we had so much of day by day we are having developments in the field of space also. But the section which we are seeing, the hypersonic, is actually a very interesting section. We'll see how hypersonic vehicles can actually be a substitute for the rockets in coming slides. Okay, anyway, as of now, you just understand there are four major categories of light vehicles. In that, the hypersonic and ultrasonic are very important, and rockets, which are completely dealing with space sciences, space exploration, falls under also ultrasonic category. Now, what is meant by a rocket? Of course, everyone must be seeing what is a rocket. And rocket is actually a type of aircraft that uses a reactive force from its propulsive system as its lifting forces. Now, unlike an airplane, of course, you do have airplanes which uses wings. Wings normally will produce lift so that you will go forward and you will fly and you will come down. But in case of a rocket, we don't have wings at all. We have to use a very highly powerful propulsive system. You can see in this picture itself, there are some rounded nozzles. So that particular so rocket depends only on the propulsive system to move forward, or we can say to lift upwards. So that is why rockets needs a special, propulsive system, or we can say engines, because it requires more lifting force, unlike a normal aircraft, which is just mostly depending on a wing, right? Of course, a rocket generally looks like a long cylindrical shaped body, and it has a, of course, conical shape at the front and nozzle at the rear. This is how we have seen rocket. Maybe some of us may be knowing what exactly happens in the rocket. Some of us may not be knowing that. Some of us we're seeing why this 4, 5, 6 are there. Okay, we'll see how it goes. Right now, rocket, this general rocket, I say, of course, for long range applications, we must go for multi-stage rockets. What is meant by stage? A stage, like for example, rocket is actually a non-orbiting engine. Like it don't actually take air from atmosphere, so it is necessary to carry oxygen with it. Of course, rocket need to carry fuel as well as oxidizer. We can say oxygen. So then, if you mix this both and combust it, you'll get high level of energy. That energy is expanded through the nozzles, which we are seeing that conical type nozzles and bell nozzles, like so many types of nozzles. So in nozzle, expansion takes place. So by means of expansion, you do get high level of thrust that moves the rocket upwards. Now, as we are carrying the oxygen with us, it is necessary to allocate a lot of space for oxygen alone. you don't have much space in case of a rocket, because rockets usually will carry payloads like satellites, a very small satellite. But to carry that to space, you need a very long, or we can say larger engine section or a core section. So if you carry a very big tank of oxygen and very big tank of fuel, and if you want to go for long distance, it is not suitable to have a very big tank. So even manufacturing wise, space wise, and all these things, weight, all these calculations are very tough to have a very big tank altogether. That's why for long range applications, we went with multi-stage rockets. Of course, multi-stage rockets means stage by stage rockets. Like finally, you'll be having capsule which carries a satellite with some propulsive systems. So we do have seen so many rocket launches with multi-stages. Initially, you do have a liftoff. After certain period of time, you will be having a separation. So next engine will start, next engine will start. So modern day rockets normally are multi-stage rockets, because mostly we'll take this payload to orbit and other interplanetary missions. So why I am telling this, because most of the rockets today are multi-stage, and stage means stage will be having every complete setup to be like a normal rocket. Now we'll have like two or three independent rockets stuck together to form what we are calling as a stages. It's an independent rocket, independently you can operate, and each stage will have its own operation, like propulsive system, guidance system, and other thrust vectoring system, all the systems. So finally, at the final stage, it contains rockets, very all important payload. Normally it is satellite. You do have other payloads like personnel and other gunpowder, everything will be there. So finally, the lower stages will break away to ensure that it takes only what is required. Okay, so it takes only what is required, because of course they are not required for us because it adds up the weight too much. Now we must be knowing what are the basic components of a space rocket. Usually you do have four basic components. I don't want to tell you too many components in rocket. We are having about 150 components in rocket. I'm just talking about the very basic components of a space rocket. Normally it has a framework, which we call it a structure, which holds the other things together. Of course, we don't have wings here, but we still have some stabilizing devices like fins and tabs and all. So generally the basic structure is what we term as framework. In case of an airplane, you call it as fuselage, whereas in case of rocket, we call it as a basic airframe or a basic structure. Now, the all important thing is the propulsive system, which actually includes the engine, the fuel tanks, and other rocket boosters. Okay, we'll come for the rocket boosters when you go further. This particular system is what we term as the heart of the whole rocket, because propulsive system, unlike airplane, it will give you the whole lot of thrust. So every thrust which produced by the rocket, which is required to lift off the rocket, is produced only by means of the propulsive system. And then you don't have any pilot or anyone to guide the rocket. So you must be having a proper guidance system. So it must be including onboard computer-based navigation, and also communication devices and control devices. Everything should be proper. So that all constitutes a guidance system. And finally, you do have payload. Normally you have satellites, or sometimes you carry some other necessities, some other warheads also, sometimes missiles also falls under rocket propulsion only. So all these things constitute the basic components of a rocket. These are the basic things. We'll go further. Now, we'll move on further. Instead of explaining what is solid rockets, what is liquid rockets, and what is hybrid rocket in detail, I'll just give you a small overview about what is solid rocket, what is liquid rocket, what is hybrid rocket, and then we'll move on to the space propulsion system. Like, once if it enters into space, what exactly we use. Now, point is very simple. Now, you do have three types of rockets based on the propellant we use. Now, first of all, we must be knowing what is the propellant. Now, propellant is nothing but the fuel, it's a combination of fuel and oxidizer. As I mentioned earlier, in rockets, we don't have any inlet or anything to take oxygen from atmosphere. And vehicles are like a human. Even for human to live, you need oxygen to inhale, and that only will make you survive. Same way, even in rockets also, even in airplanes also, to make the fuel to burn, we must inhale oxygen, or we must give oxygen into the combustion chamber. But as I said earlier, you don't have any air breathing mechanism in case of rockets. So we must carry oxidizer and also one fuel. So fuel and oxidizer constitute the propellant. So propellant is nothing but the combination of, or we can say individual also we can say, so propellant is nothing but the combination of fuel as well as the oxidizer. Now if we use fuel in the form of solid, then the whole rocket or the whole motor, they say it is motor also, the whole vehicle will be called as solid rockets. So please remember, if the rocket uses solid fuel or fuel in the form of solid and also the propellant like oxygen also in the form of solid, not only fuel, both fuel as well as oxidizer, both should be in the form of solid, then it is called solid rocket. Now you can ask, sir, how oxygen is available in our like phase only though? Yes, we do have oxygen in the form of solid, in the form of liquid, as well as in the form of where it is, right? So solid rocket means the rocket which uses both fuel and oxidizer in the form of solid, whereas liquid rocket is just opposite to that, where both fuel and the propellant will be in the form of liquid only. And finally, hybrid rockets, which are actually preferred in case of missiles, normally we'll discuss why they are not used as a regular starter in case of a rockets, not conventional rocket, we'll discuss it. But anyway, hybrid rockets are actually the combination of either one solid and another one liquid. So it can be normally it is fuel will be in the form of solid, whereas oxidizer in the form of liquid. There is another one type also, that is reverse type of a hybrid rocket. That means the fuel will be in the form of liquid, whereas oxidizer will be in the form of solid. That is very, very difficult and it is not commonly used also. So we'll see what is solid rocket for a time, then we'll go to the next phase. First, as I mentioned, solid propellant is actually a monopropellant fuel and oxidizer. It's a mixture of both fuel and oxidizer in a solid form. Now how we can make it? Is it easy to make? Yes, it is quite easy to make. You have a solid, you just grind it, powder it, and make it a mixture with the grinded oxidizer. So mix it with proper proportions. Even in bike cars also, you will not mix the same amount of fuel with the same amount of compressed air. No, you will be having a stoichiometric ratio. So based on the ratio, you can mix it here and you mold it and you can use it as a, so that particular form is what we term it as grain, grain, grain. So they call it as propellant grain. So propellant grain is what a mixture, I mean powdered and mixed and molded form of the solid fuel and solid oxidizer in proper proportions. So that's what very important is. Now of course you do have performance related things, like if you want to have very high thrust at the initial stages, you can make a very different bores. If you want to have very low thrust initial, but with respect to time, you need to increase the amount of thrust produced, you can make perforations based on that. That's why it's not about the solid rockets alone. That's why I'm not showing anything with the solid rockets and explaining it. Just a basic about solid rockets. It's not that grains mixture only will determine the thrust produced. It's also the perforations or the grain configurations which we use will influence the thrust produced. But the major letdown of the solid rocket is that it cannot be throttled. Not like you will not control. What is mean by throttling? Suppose if you drive a bike or a car, you have accelerator. When you press the accelerator, the amount of the fuel going into the engine is controlled. So the amount is controlled. The controlling of that particular mass flow of fuel is what we term as throttling. So in case of solid rockets, it's impossible to have a throttling once if the ignition is started initially. So you will not have anything called throttling. That's the big problem with solid rocket. That's why if you say rockets, you normally say it as liquid rockets. Okay, if you say rockets, generally it is liquid rockets only. Solid rockets, we'll see what are the other applications of solid rocket, but these are the basic components of a solid rocket. Now you can see this right side of the figure, you do have ignition charge, you have casing, you have grain, which I said the powdered, mixed and molded form of both solid fuel and solid oxidizer in a proper proportion. That is what we term as grain. Then we do have a seal. Then we have a nozzle. Now, the second picture, that is a green color picture, shows you the exact interior view of a solid rocket. Now, if you say the cross section, at the center, you'll be having a small pore. That pore is what we term as perforation. Now, that bore will actually allow the ignition to spread throughout the body. So if you ignite initially, like ignition charge is there, if you allow the ignition at the initial, then it will spread throughout the body, so that you will get a very high level of surface burning surface. So it's like burning a paper. So slowly it will progress, it gives a hot gas, same thing. So at the center you'll be having before you ignite, after you ignite you'll be seeing a orange color light. Now you know every part of the bore or perforation will get ignited, so it will burn. So the result of the burning is that it gives very, very hot gas. Now when the hot gas enters into the nozzle, which is mentioned here, the nozzle's function is to convert the potential energy, that is very hot potential energy, into corresponding kinetic energy. Now our particular aim is to produce high level of velocity gas, or we can say jet, high velocity gas. For that only you are burning the grain, you are getting hot gas, you are expanding it through nozzle. So that's all we are doing, only to get high velocity at the exit, then only it will produce a proper thrust at upward. So that's what the theory behind the working of a rocket. Now here we are instantly doing by burning the fuel and oxidizer mixture, that is called grain. It's very simple, but as I said earlier, it is not generally used as a main rocket, because you can't control the thrust also. It will not go for a long time also. You can't use it for long range applications also. That's why these particular solid rockets are used as strap-on boosters for space launch vehicles. But strap-on boosters, of course, at the time of launch, you can see some small boosters at the sides of the main rocket. Initially, the main engine will not be ignited. Only the strap-on boosters, small boosters, will be ignited. So they will give an instant thrust. So you will get a liftoff. So that is where we are using the solid boosters or solid rockets. Of course, second application is that it can be used for upper stage propulsion for orbital transfer vehicles. Of course, once if you have these satellites or your particular your target is achieved, there from there you need to propagate, you need to propel, you need to move. So for that also you use a they call it as OTV, that is orbital transfer vehicles. For that propulsion also we use this solid rockets. Of course, we use solid rockets for many tactical missiles and strategic missiles, because they are long range, they are very short range. We can use you can use this for short range, and more importantly, in many of the aircrafts we do want initial takeoff. That is what we term as jet assisted takeoff, JATO. That jet assisted takeoff is also possible having solid boosters implemented in that. Of course, you do have gas generators, which will, if you go in depth about liquid propellant rockets, you have many feeding systems. In that, we use gas generators to produce hot gas. There also we use solid propellants. And finally, attitude control propulsion system. This is very important. What is attitude control propulsion system? Now, if it is a normal airplane, you can move the control surfaces and you can somehow control the position of the airplane and all. But in case of rocket, you don't have any control surfaces. We don't have wings at all. So how we can control the attitude of the rocket? How we can control the direction and everything? What we can do is we can have a small jet at the side, so you'll get the proper roll. So it's like you control the attitude by means of a secondary rocket. So if it's going like this, you make a small angle and you pass some gas through it, so that you will have a like small rotation. So this is how you can control the attitude also. So for that also we use solid rockets. Now we'll move into the next, that is liquid propellant rockets. Obviously, liquid propellant rocket is a very big very, very big topic. I'm not going to tell everything. I'm just going to give you a small idea about what is rocket. Of course, most of you must be knowing, but whatever information I can share, I can try it. Right now, liquid propellant rocket is not like a solid rocket. Here, we use propellants, that is both fuel and oxidation in the form of liquid itself, because we can easily throttle, we can easily control the thrust, we can easily store also. Everything is very, very easy. That's why we go for liquid propellant rockets. I will tell you, if you say rockets, it is all about liquid propellant rockets only. 90% of the rockets which we use today are actually liquid propellant rockets. So other boosters and all, only we use solid rockets. So generally, liquid rockets are actually the rockets which we use today. Now, as I said earlier, there are so many types of rockets also, monopropellant, bipropellant. Monopropellant means you combine both fuel and oxidation into one compound and you store it in one particular tank, you burn it. Bipropellant means you store fuel and oxidation separately, you combine it, you burn it. That's what we term it as bipropellants. So not going in depth about that because we have other topics to cover. The point is the third type, that is hybrid rockets. What is this hybrid rocket? See, you do have problem with solid rockets, like it is not possible to throttle, some problems are there, and you have some problems with liquid also, like it is very heavy and it is very tough to it is very complex because you have many, it's a liquid, right? It's not tightly packed, so it's not compact. So by to eliminate all these two disadvantages, you go for hybrid rocket, which is just a combination of one solid and other liquid. As I mentioned earlier, generally fuel is used as a solid, fuel is used in solid form, and liquid oxidizer will be there. So that is the best combination, and it can be used to shut down easily, it can be easily throttleable, all these things are there. But still, why these hybrid rockets are not in use in a general use today? As I mentioned earlier, 90% of the rockets are liquid rockets. Why not hybrid rockets? Why? Because there are so many practical disadvantages also. Like mixing a fuel, solid fuel and liquid oxidizer instantly is not possible. It's very challenging also. That is a big letdown. And the fuel is very, very limited, because fuel and oxidizer need to be in the same, we can say, chemical formula. You will not find it very easy. It's very rare. That's why hybrid rockets are still not very popular with long range applications, but still we use it for military applications like missiles and other short range combat things. Right now we'll go for the next level of propulsion. Now we have seen, till now we have seen only the chemical propulsion, like liquid oxidized, liquid fuel, all these things. Now we'll move to the next level, that is called advanced propulsion techniques. That's what we normally use today in space. Okay, out of these four, there are so many other things also, but these are the four prominently spoken or more prominently used and are under research propulsion techniques, space propulsion techniques. Now, first is electric rocket propulsion, second is ion propulsion techniques, third nuclear rocket, and fourth one is solar sail. Now, there are some miracles, there are some, we can say, like unbelievable phenomena, which we may not believe, but it is theoretically proven, like solar sail. We'll see what is it. Now, electrical rocket propulsion, of course, it is a very old method. It is predominantly using electrical power to accelerate the propellant by different possible, it can be electrothermal or magnetic means. Now, what we do in chemical rockets, like liquid rocket, solid rocket, and hybrid rocket, we burn the fuel and oxidation mixture. We are burning it, so it produces hot gas. Now, in case of this electric propulsion, we don't burn it. We just heat it. We heat it and we expand it through nozzle and we get thrust out of it. So that is what electric rocket is all about. So electric rocket involves electricity. Now, you may ask how we can get electricity in space. Is it possible? Yes, it is possible. We'll see a video. I will show you how we can get solar thermal energy to generate electricity, and then we can use it for a source for electric rocket propulsion. So wherever you go, you do have solar energy. So solar energy is used to as actually generator. So you have a very long solar cells. You have a very large solar cells. You generate electricity, give it as an input to the electric rocket so that we can generate thrust out of it. So I again tell you, these advanced propulsion techniques may not be suitable from the ground. still I am telling you, you do have electric rocket, you do have iron rocket, you do have nuclear, you have solar cell, but still, which is dominating? Chemical rockets are dominating because there are so many difficulties in this four also. We'll see that also. But electric rockets don't burn the fuel and oxidation mixture. They just heat the fuel and oxidation mixture or even any mixture. Then it produces a thrust. Okay, so it uses, of course, unlike chemical systems, electric propulsion requires very little mass to accelerate the spacecraft. You don't need to give too many, because I will tell you that there is a statistics which say chemical rockets can be efficient only 35 to 45% near the space. Of course, it is not completely efficient. Chemical rockets are not completely efficient. The specific fuel consumption is very high. All these things are there. So they are only efficient to 35 to 45% only. But if you use this advanced propulsion techniques, especially the coming techniques, you can get about 70 to 80% of efficiency. That's the most important thing. So you are not wasting anything, but you are getting too much from the setup. So here the propellant is ejected 20 times faster than the classical thermal classical chemical thrusters. So you have a high powerful thrust and without much investment. Okay, so now the most important of all this four is iron propulsion. Now why I'm saying most important, because most of the space vehicles today uses iron propulsive techniques in space. Of course, you can carry rocket, you can take rocket, you can do whatever it may be, but when it enters the space, the king is iron propulsion. Iron propulsive techniques are the dominating propulsive techniques in the space. You need chemical rockets to carry from the ground, through the atmosphere, all everything is fine. But once it reaches space, iron propulsion is what we normally use today. Okay, right. What is this iron propulsion? What is this? Okay, I'm speaking too long. Let us see a small video. Then we'll come back to what is iron propulsion. I want someone to tell me whether it is audible or not.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Right, okay. Right, fine. It's not audible. It don't need to be audible because I will explain it. Right, fine. So this is not prepared by me. It's taken from NASA site. Now, point is, I repeat once again. It's very fast. Now, this is what I said. Now, if you see the picture, if you see the screen, you can see a chemical rocket which is taking the particular satellite, which is this is the cone. I hope you can see the pointer also. Right. This is a screen. This is a cone where you keep a satellite. Now, these many attachments are just to produce the thrust, just to keep the thing going and carry that particular cone to the space. So this particular thrust is what we get by means of chemical rockets. You burn the fuel and oxidizer and you produce a hot gas. So this is a clear example of chemical rockets. Now once if it goes, it carries and finally it reaches the space. Once if it reaches the space, this is what the capsule we're talking about. This is what the real thing which you send actually. Now, what is this? What are the other two? What are the other two umbrella like thing? We'll see what is it. Now, as I said earlier, you need to have the electrical power. So these two are nothing but the solar panels. Solar panels. So solar panels actually receive sunlight energy and they convert it into electrical energy and they give it as a input to the iron propulsive chamber. Right now, again, okay. What is happening? Let us I'll explain it first. Let us have a glance at the video. Now what exactly there in the okay now what is happening? We are just having one set of there are basic components of iron propulsive device. You actually pass high speed electrons into the propellant. So you have propellant, you pass high speed electrons. Now why we are doing it? I hope you heard about ionization, like electronic bombardment. So if you hit a stable at a stable molecule by means of high speed electrons, it will become atomized, it will break down, right? So it will be broke, it will be broken down into positive and negative. Now okay, so we actually break the propellants, like we do have propellants here, but we are not burning it here. Unlike electrothermal, we are not heating it also. What we are doing, we are just passing high speed electrons on the propellant molecules and break them into positive and negative. And we attract all the negative. This positive will become accelerated by means of magnetization. So they, that positive things will be pushed out or accelerated through a grid. So that the exhaust, the exit will be accelerated exit. By that we can get thrust. It's a very simple mechanism. What I am doing is I am just bombarding a molecule, propellant molecule. It can be a, it can be anything. It can, normally it is a propellant, like you use a like a helium or xenon or anything. Now what I am doing, I am just bombarding it and making it to positive and negative, and I am attracting negative alone. Positive only will remain here. That positive is attracted at the back, so it is accelerated at the back, so it goes out with high speed, so that produces a little thrust. I'll tell you, in space there is no drag at all. In space there is no drag at all, so little push is enough for you to get a high speed. So that is why you don't want chemical rockets there, you don't want chemicals there, you want a push, continuous push, so that you can move further to a destination where you are intended. So that push is required. The for that you don't need to produce a huge explosion, all these things. That is what is happening in a ion propulsion. So I will run this video again. So this white color is nothing but so you have gridded ion thruster. So inside we can see a discharge chamber in which a neutral atom is released. An electron is released, so that will bombard the electron, sorry, neutral atom. So the positive will get accelerated through electrodes, whereas negative is released from the neutralizer. And of course, listen, okay, well, the process release repeats. So this is a very simple thing, and this is how the beam looks like. This is how you go in a space. I repeat once again, in space the drag is very, very minimum. The drag is very, very minimum, and you don't have any like obstacle or anything. So a small push is enough to navigate. Now how it is produced, again I will tell you, you do have a chamber in which your atom, propellant molecule, say the neutral atom, that is propellant molecule, that is kept, and then you do have high speed electrons that will be bombarded to the particular neutral atom. Neutral atom will become positive and negative. That is proton and neutron. So that particular proton and right, so positive and negative. Now the positive things are remain there, and negative things are attracted at the side. Now again you have to give back to the this particular plume, na, that is the plume which you are getting. That plume will be should be neutralized, otherwise you know that will create a toxicity in the space propulsion. So it will be like a very, very highly radiative. That's why we will not leave the positive photons alone. If you release the photons alone, that will be like it is very, very dangerous also. Now I repeat the process again. Now what we do, we bombard it and we accelerate the positive. Yes, we accelerate the positive photon alone, then the remaining negatives also is actually combined at the exit, so that it'll get neutralized. Okay, so that is how the process goes. Now this is actually a simple ion thruster. Of course, to make sure that you have punch. What is punch? Listen, suppose if you have a, if you have, I hope you are seeing me, if you have a water jet, okay, water jet is sprayed on you with high velocity, then it gives a punch. So you, if you give a punch only, you will have a reactive force. Suppose we have dispersed flow, you will not feel the punch. So you have a grid to ensure that the punch is a static one. So you will not have a, you will be having a narrow passage of partially charged particles in an accelerated manner. If it is dispersed, then you will not have a impact. Now, as I mentioned, there are many methods for ionization, but the most common method which we use is electron bombardment. We do have radio frequency, you do have field emission, microwave and ion contact. But in ion propulsion techniques, we use electron bombardment only, right? Now, next we'll move to the next topic, that is nuclear rocket. Now, nuclear rocket, I will tell you, from 1960s, NASA is actually doing a very big process about nuclear rockets. Like they have a dedicated section called NERVA, NERVA, NERVA. You can go and find it also. NERVA is actually a part of JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory. They are investing too much in that, and they got good results also. So for 50, 60 years, they are making it. What is nuclear rocket? It's very simple. Yeah.
Sorry to bother you. Can you please go to written previous slides of methods, like methods to ionization? Not to cause ionization, while you just slide, you know? Yes, thank you, sir.
Shall I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, of course, here we use a liquid propellant, which is normally hydrogen, which is very, very rare actually. So what we do, we take hydrogen and you pass it through a nuclear reactor. Normally we do have a nuclear fission and fusion. Anyway, you have a high level of what we say heat propagation. So that heat propagation or heat release, that heat release utilized to heat the liquid oxidizer, or I mean liquid propellants. So that liquid propellants will become gas, hot gas. That hot gas is supplied to the nozzle. So you do obviously get expansion and you get a thrust. Very simple concept, but it's not simple like which we look, because NASA themselves are trying it for more than 50-60 years. It's not simple, but the process looks very, very easily understandable. You do have a liquid hydrogen tank which is controlled by means of control valve, so that we can get what you require. Then it is operated by means of a fuel pump. So fuel pump pressurizes the liquid propellant. So it pushes the liquid propellant to the reactor, nuclear reactor, where you do have core and control rods, all these things where you have nuclear reaction taking place. So as a result of nuclear reaction, you have a high release of heat. That heat is utilized to heat the liquid hydrogen. So that liquid hydrogen, that is liquid propellant, gets very much heated, and that gets that results in a very hot gas. That hot hydrogen gas is passed through nozzle, that produces a thrust, that required thrust. Of course, some part of the nuclear, the hot gas is taken to a turbine to run the fuel pump also, because you know, right, the pump will not operate on its own. You need a source to run the turbine, so pump. So you use a turbine to rotate, we need to have a hot gas. So this is a very simple, easy understanding of nuclear rocket. But I will tell you what are the challenges of nuclear rockets and why we go for nuclear rocket. Nuclear rocket, of course, it can provide electricity, heat, and propulsion for future space missions. You have a very good source, but we'll see what are the challenges. Of course, it is high propellant efficiency. Completely it will be heated. You don't need to worry about partial heating, less thrust and all. Pakka heating will be there. And of course, it is very fast method for human solar system mission. If you want to go reach a solar system or any other long range applications, we can go with nuclear rocket. You can ask me why it is still not in use. Of course, it reduces fuel consumption and it increases payload carrying capacity, all these things. But there are big challenges ahead for nuclear rocket. First challenge is it is extremely complex in terms of energy. See, nuclear reactions, once if it is started, it's not easy to stop. It's very, very tough to stop, and it's very tough to control also. And second thing is they are very, very heavy. Nuclear rockets are very heavy because it uses so many things like radiation shielding. You do need a turbo machinery. You need to have core properly. It will all add with the dead weight of the rocket, which is not desirable. We can't use this. Now, the problem is not all this too. The big problem is like the risk of explosion. of course, even though no rocket is 100% successful and reliable till now in case of solid nuclear rocket, we don't know what is the future ahead. But the problem is, once if you explosion, it is very, very tough to control, and it will create a very mass destruction, and nobody wants to see that. That's why even developed countries like US, Russia, all those countries, actually they stopped using nuclear now. They are shutting off their nuclear plants, and right, finally they're more costly, and only trained professional people can only operate this. That's why we can't afford to have a normal nuclear rocket. These are the challenges ahead with the nuclear rocket. And finally, we'll go for solar sail, which is actually if you say Mach number 20 in a rocket is very tough to get. By means of solar sail, we can get up to 90 Mach number, 90. According to JPL, NASA, they are saying that solar sail can give you Mach number more than 90, and you can reach sun by 60 minutes itself. Within 60 minutes, we can reach 1 AU, that is 1 crore kilometer. So you can easily reach 1 AU within 1 hour. That is the mission by JPL, NASA. This is solar sail. What is solar sail? Solar sail is actually another form of spacecraft propulsion, which uses radiation pressure exerted by the sunlight. The peculiar thing is that we don't need to have anything. We don't need to have propellants. We don't need to have any heating mechanism. We don't need anything. This is the point with solar sails. Now, solar sails uses a very large mirrors. We can say foils. They say it, some people will say it is foil, vanes, all these things. Now, how it came? This particular thing, research about solar sails started in 1608 itself. That is 1608, like very early, like Kepler, he proposed like there was sail wind which can, like a ship, right? If you have ship, some ships will have sailing ships. They have some fabrics. So if you have strong wind, we don't need to do anything. Automatically it will push the boat or ship in the direction of the wind. So Kepler, he sensed this, and he told the same thing can happen in case of rocket also. If you have a large extended surface, by means of solar winds, it can be carried forward. So you don't need to have any propulsion mechanism, all these things. Of course, 64, there were some further stories behind that. Then 80s, 90s, and everything. Finally, what happened? Am I audible?
Now it's okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, fine. Now, finally, in 2019, of course, I said even SpaceX also and Falcon also, they are implementing the same concept of having solar sails. Solar sails are very, very useful because they don't use anything. They don't use propellants. They don't use anything. Now, you can see from this also a small picture which can tell you what is it. You have sunlight. It releases photons. It gets bounced back by the foil. It gives out the thrust in the direction of the waves. Now, sail pointed at sun experiences force. Sun pushes the sail direct way. Reflected light generates reaction force. So you have to adjust the angle at which you face the sun. If you adjust the angle at which you face the sun, you can navigate in the same way. That is what the concept behind solar sail. Now, solar sail cannot be launched from the ground straight away. A small indication of how it can be launched. It starts with a normal rocket. It gets separated. It becomes a capsule mode. Then it gets extended. So I'll play a very short video. Then you can understand what is this. So generally it is getting, see how it is getting expanded. The core portion is very small, but you need to navigate. Still, you do have solar panels to produce the black color things, are solar panels to produce electricity to power the satellite. So how it gets extended? So you do have foils with hub. They get extended slowly, and it can be unfolded like this. It looks very small. They use carbon sheets so that it will not get damaged easily. Very, very macro carbon sheets. So it can be like it can be extended up to even 2 kilometers of surface. So you can, that much it has. So the more it is exposed to the sun, the more faster it goes. Okay. Now there are three types of solar sails based on its shape. Normally you have square sail and heligyro solar sail, and finally spinning disk sail. I don't want to explain too much about that. I'm just giving you a short idea about a sail. Based on the shape of the extension, you classify it into three. And of course, before you launch, this is actually, you have ground deployment test, suborbital test, like which you are seeing now. Ground deployment, you have to extend it completely. Now, finally, where we can use this in future? It can be used for exploration of solar system and beyond. We do have Voyager 2 and all, it's still going. It stopped now after 25 years of service. Now, so you can use this because there is no propellant at all. And of course, to deliver any science instruments to space stations, then if you want to maintain any special orbit, artificial orbits, you can make it. And of course, if you want to deliver any large cargo and even people in the future, we can do it with solar sails. And we can, of course, we can use it for planetary protection also. All these things are future. Still now, there is no such successful mission through solar sails. Okay. So finally, we have seen all the space related propulsive systems. But for all, we have so many disadvantages and all these things are there, limitations are there. So I'm telling you again, chemical rockets are the rockets which are 90% used today. Other things are small experimental rockets and all. So you have a problem like chemical rockets are not much effective. And more importantly, chemical rockets use, they don't use oxygen from atmosphere. So you have to carry a separate oxygen tank. So then only you can use it. Otherwise, you can't take oxygen from atmosphere, all these things. And you don't have wings to produce lift also. So there are so many disadvantages with the rocket also. Now, the future, how the future will look like? There will be vehicles which will actually substitute rockets. So we will not have any rockets. See, previously we had helicopters and cameras to actually capture a drone like view. But today a small drone will do everything. Same way, in future, you do have systems which will replace the rockets also. So what is, they are actually called hypersonic vehicles. They are still under research. Very near future, you can see this. Now, why they are advantages? Because they use oxygen from atmosphere. And also by doing this, you don't need to carry oxygen aboard. You don't need to carry in on board. So you can significantly reduce weight. And also it don't take much propellant also. It takes only 1/7 of the propellant which normally a rocket takes. That is the main point here. Because 7 times we are reducing the fuel consumption. So you can go 7 times further. And more importantly, these orbiting vehicles have very good maneuverability because they depend on aerodynamic forces rather than a propulsive force which is happening in a rocket. It's very highly safe because many times we see rockets are one-time usable and they fall into ocean, all these things. You know, failure rates can be reduced. Even though India is good at that, but other developed countries still don't have a success rate more than 50 also. So all those things can be reduced by means of this particular hypersonic vehicles. Now, previously we had hypersonic vehicles like SR-72 Blackbird, SR-71 Blackbird. Now in 2013, US have used SR-71. By 2021, they are coming with SR-72. That is, SR-72 can record Mach number more than 6, whereas SR-71 recorded Mach number 3.3. Now with this, we can have much more faster vehicle. So we don't need to go with a rocket. We can actually, SR-71 was a surveillance airplane, but this can be used as a hypersonic spy plane. Now, hypersonic vehicle plane. So you can take rockets, you can take spacecrafts, you can take satellites also. We can launch it and we can come back. So reusable also we can use. Now, SR-72 is just a concept. I mean, like it may come in near future. Now, this is actually a combination of both a normal turbojet as well as a ramjet dual mode with movable inlet, so we can use it as a scramjet also. Now this point is under construction, but still I can say you this can be reaching only about Mach number 6, 6.5, not more than that. But the one which we are going to see next is what we termed as Sabre, which is developed by, which is nothing but synergetic air breathing rocket engine. This actually developed by Reaction Engines of Britain. They named it as Skylon. So Skylon is the name which they gave. Now this can reach about Mach number 25, which is actually almost more than a rocket also. So this is going to be a future, and they have conducted many tests also. Most of them are positive. What is this? They use actually combination of both rocket mode as well as the airplane mode. Now we'll see a small short video, very short video of this, and then we'll finish it. Now this is a demonstration of their concept. That is, from the ground they are taking off. It's not like rocket which takes off vertically. It can take off with a very long runway. Now with that runway, they are getting the enough thrust. On the sides we can see Sabre engines, so you can take off, and slowly you can see that it looks like a rocket. That much power it can produce, but there are so many limitations in that. But still, if you can reuse it again and again, you can save a lot amount of money, because rockets generally are used only one time. Now if you use reusable launch vehicle like this, that too, it's not reusable launch vehicle, it's directly a launch vehicle, so it can substitute rockets in very near future. So you can see how it looks like from the ground. It takes off with jet boosted takeoff, then with stages, with time, it increases further and it escapes the atmosphere, and it goes, it reaches the space also. Very, very nice idea. Now how it is possible, and we can have 1,000 questions how it is possible, because if you use gas driven engines, the biggest problem is the more speed you go, the more heat will be produced. Suppose if you go at Mach number 3, 4, 5, you know what happens? The temperature will be very, very high. With high temperature, the core engines will melt at all. Everything will melt. Even SR-71 was like 3.3 itself, it has some trouble. But how this particular Sabre can reach about 25? How? Because they use a technology called pre-cooler. What is pre-cooler? They use a pre-cooling section. So pre-cooling technology is designed in a manner that it can cool even 1000 degrees Celsius to normal 15 degrees Celsius within 1/20th of the second. So within a second, it can cool from 1000 to 1015. That technology they use. So when you use that technology, we don't need to worry about the turbine blades. We don't need to worry about the other sections which may undergo high creep or thermal heating. So that is the biggest finding, that like they use a pre-cooling technology which can cool anything into normal temperature within seconds. Now this can be the future. I will tell you, you do have an air intake section which can operate from 0 to 5.4. this cone is movable. You can move the cone so that you can operate at very, very high speeds also. Now next is what we term it as air pre-cooler, which have thousands and thousands of sections inside. So you pass it and you keep it very, very cool, keeping engine components cool at very high second, 1/20th of second, it will produce cooling. That's how you can save the remaining section thrust chamber. Okay, now point is, you do have a core engine with helium turbine and air compressor. Normally it produces a high level of, see, I will tell you, you have propulsive technology to produce Mach number 20 or 30 also, but you don't have materials to withstand that. That's the problem we have. So for that only they go with pre-cooling concept. This concept is, of course, this is a sectioned view of that. Now listen, if you take a normal Boeing 777, it goes at Mach number 0.7, whereas Concorde, which was in service until 2000s, they went up to 1.52 also, but it was stopped from service. Then SR-71 3.3 it went, but still it was stopped from service. Now Saber, we can say it can go up to Mach number 5 initially and can peak up to 25. That's why this plays a major role. The point is very simple. They have pre-cooler, that technology which can reduce the temperature right from 1000 to 150 degrees Celsius within even seconds. That is why they are confident in replacing the rockets by means of the Saber type. Now finally, we'll discuss about the DARPA hypersonic air breathing weapon concept. This is not exactly a rocket mission, but this is actually a dedicated mission by US. What they are doing, they are having an air breathing hypersonic vehicle which can be acting as a missile which enters into space and come back and with hypersonic speed itself. So you don't need to have any vehicle to keep your missile into the space. It itself acts as a missile, and it works with scramjet mechanism. It takes atmospheric air and produces Mach number 7, 8. Then it enters into space, go to the location, come back, combat, again finish the phase. This is how it works out. So this is developed by Lockheed Martin, and this is going to be the future of we can say defensive technologies. Only one country has this, that is US. Okay, so this is how it looks like, and India is not too far behind. India also have launched trial HSTDV, that is hypersonic technology demonstrator vehicle, and which are developed by DRDO. And you know what they are saying, that we are developing a hypersonic missile that will be powered by a scramjet, of course with a rectangular indent, and they use dual use technology. Like, it can be used for military purpose, it can be used for launching satellites at lower cost. So I can say the future of space technology in our country is very, very good, because we are developing a low cost satellite launching vehicle. Even though even in space technology also, we are launching 100 satellites together by using cryogenics all, but still it is low cost, because every other country is giving their satellites to our particular country to launch it. Same way, in coming future, this HSTDV can launch satellites with lower cost, so that it can boost our country's economy also. So anyway, so with that, I will not go further. I will stop the session here. So if you have any doubts, anything to clarify, you can always ask me with this contact. And I expect organizers to yes. have further yeah to take over. Yes.
Any doubts for the participants, you can ask them. So we will have a minute for the doubts.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, Arpit.
Sir, I having one doubt about that pre-cooler is there, na? Sir, you told that you are suddenly cooling this one from 1000 degree to 15 degree Celsius in within 120 second. So, sir,
yes.
We are cooling that much, then there will be a metal glass formation will be there, or the fragile will be there, and the metal will convert into the crystallization.
Correct. You may have a sudden cooling means it may have formation of ice cubes and ice formation may be there. So point is, you will not have a complete flow of air. You will be having a thin holes. So they use a mechanism, like if you see that particular picture, you have thousands of, it's not like single, you have thousands of traps, you have thousands of veins, like thinner than a human hair. So it allows cooling. So you don't have a mass flow of air. You do have a very thin formation, thin flow of air. So that means you will not allow the ice to form in that itself. It's not like massly you are cooling. You are cooling through patterns. You are through cooling through patterns, like a helical pattern, or what we say, like the passages are very, very small. So it will not allow the formation of ice. Can you understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
So in the short section, one more doubt is there.
Yeah.
From Madhav, what is meant by planetary protection?
Okay. Now listen. Of course, maybe some. You have heard about debris, space debris. Of course, you must be knowing about space debris. Of course, there are so many polluted or expired satellites which are can say revolving around our planet here and there. And there are chances that it may come back. It may fall into any land also, or it may hit other vehicles also. So with this particular mission, we can actually have we can have proper space debris management. Like even China is doing it. What they are doing, they are implementing a laser source. So they detect the space debris which is not required. They point out the source and they will make that particular expired satellites into ashes. So they protect that active satellites by means of this particular space debris management. So solar sails in future can also be like that. So they can protect the existing active satellites and planetary satellites from the expired satellites hitting them. Okay, that is what we term as planetary protection. You got the answer?
I hope you got the answer, sir.
Okay,
fine. Any more doubts from the participants?
Hello, sir. Sunaini here.
Yeah, Sunaini. Tell.
So actually, you have mentioned about helium turbine, sir. What is it actually, sir? And how it works?
Which one? Like here?
In the components,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah. Okay, fine. They will maintain that much temperature, because that temperature at which even though you reduce that to room temperature, still you do have core there, right? Again, to the turbine only it should go. So at that temperature, again, if it hits that particular turbine blades may again fail. So after core only, creep again. So they use a cooling mechanism like helium, you know, right? So it can be used as a coolant also. They use it further. It will avoid the turbine from failure again. Okay, so they didn't mention much about that. This is how they don't have any specific reason why they use a helium cooled turbine. Okay, so if possible, let me also find it, because they didn't mention in which they have mentioned this much information itself. They didn't release, because they are about to have a test flight by 2021, but unfortunately they release any information at all. You can browse through internet also, you can get very limited information only. So they didn't, because you know that, right? Today there are so much of competition in the field of space exploration also. And they will come with that particular idea. So they don't have much clear idea about that. But we can pretend like that is just a cooling mechanism to ensure that turbine blades will not fail further. Okay.
Yeah, sir. And I have one more question.
Yes.
Could you please comment on the combustion of Sabre engines in in the rocket mode and in the airplane mode, sir?
Now listen
mode.
Here, it's like just like a scramjet engine only, old scramjet. Like you have a cone, you like say it's like a dual mode. Like, okay, I will explain you with SR-71, then you can easily understand that, right? Now you see the splitter, you can see the right. The cone will act as inlet which produces this shock wave. Okay, because if you cross more than Mach number 1, it has to ensure that the combustion will not be too much of supersonic. If the combustion is too supersonic, then there are problems like mixing and combustion. That's why at inlet you need to have a core to shock. Same way here they made a splitter, but in case of Haber they made a nose cone like this. So the nose cone will from 0 to 5 you will have a shockwave mode, so that they will have a high level compression. A compressor here. So inlet itself need to use a compressor like a ramjet only. So they use a cone. That cone will produce shock. That by means of shock they produce compressed air. Then only from 0 to 5. After 5, the cone will be moved inside. You cannot see a much cone section there. The cone will move like go inside, so that it will only give the inlet to the incoming air. Okay, that is how it produces a it enters into rocket mode. So before that, it is actually so up to 0 to 5 only it acts as a ramjet mode. After that, it goes like a rocket mode only. Normal inlet, compress it. So, sir, thrust. That's the same. That's the concept behind that. The cone is actually a movable center body. You can see this. It's a movable cone. You got the point?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Hello, sir. Any more doubts?
Hello, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, what speed can humans withstand? Like Mach speed? Or can this Saber engine be used in space travel?
Expose any of the surface, like suppose if you are taking human, you are not going to expose them to the outer atmosphere. Only the outer shells, the outer layer will undergo sublimation. Of course, your question is right. It's not that the human can withstand, it's that the materials which we use at the outer shells need to withstand. Okay, like it can go up to Mach number 25, but the point is how they are going to make the outer structure is a question mark. Inside the engine, see, go atomic heating up when you cross Mach number 10. It's very, very tough to ensure that the outer shells will not undergo ablation, like it will go into ashes. The point is, inside the engine only you have you can say 3000, 4000 degrees Celsius. That's why they are providing pre-cooler. Outside sections, they may use, which can even withstand up to you can say withstand up to 3000 degrees Celsius without any damage or any change. Outer structure is the question mark here. Intersection is what they have explained till now. And humans, of course, you will not get anywhere affected by means of the outer aerodynamic. But the outer shells is a question mark again. Good question anyway.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, recently you have talked about space debris. So, space debris, like, are we going to bring back to Earth or we are going to destroy them? Because
yeah,
both of the things are nearly too impossible. Like, because I have studied that even in the lower Earth orbit, the space debris are a lot in numbers. Like, there are 5,000 to 6,000, and this is even very much. How we are going to deal with this problem?
Okay. Now, with the help of other developed countries, space developed countries like US, Russia. So, if you browse through the internet, you can easily understand. But as you said, very, very tough it is, because the whole space is congested due to these used, expired it's not like one country will do everything and all. China have developed a laser because what they do, they make a high, we can say high magnitude, high powerful laser source. They identify the space debris which are not active. They point and with that, they bring back the residues and dump it in the ground. So for that, they are charging for all the other countries. Suppose if India's process and they charge it from our country. So this is how they are going to, they are planning to make a space debris management. So management managing the expired satellites and simply revolving satellites. It's very, very tough. But China have already developed a vehicle to destroy, or we can say to decompose the particular unnecessary vehicles and to bring it the countries which have which expert satellites revolving around them. Okay, I hope you got the answer.
Yes, sir. Okay. Location, because up till now we are at the students, so it won't be very much easy for us to direct them and to destroy them. So we are working on its location, its imaging. Think that will it be successful or not? Because I have heard from many of the mentors, like, you guys are doing something very much difficult kind of, and it won't be. Yep.
See, listen, your aim is very good. Your objective is very, very good. I feel difficulty because it's not difficult. You see, with satellites, and this is the place you can spot also. But how you are going to launch it? How you are going to launch it? Because you take US, they are appreciating students' projects. They take cubes and to just what we say, they do it by a balloons only, right? They do it by a balloons only. They will not go entirely into the space. Mission is very good. Your idea is very, very good. The problem you may face is that you do can sense it, you do can spot it, you do can even you can destroy it. But how you are going to test it? With high weather balloon, you can go up to certain altitude only. You will not go entirely into the space. So, but debris will be available only in the space only. So, only issue there. Otherwise, your idea is very good because very rarely you find space debris management related satellites, sensors and all. Very rarely, very, very rarely, because people are not ready to get money out of it. Your concept is good. My question is, like, how we are going to test it in space? Very good, very good.
Sir, can you please share your LinkedIn ID so it will be helpful for us?
Unfortunately, I'm not in LinkedIn. I can show you the.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay, fine.
So, before going to the next question, like, can all the participants switch on the camera so that we can take a screen snap?
Okay, I will stop sharing then, so you'll get the proper slides.
Okay, friend.